So let's talk day-to-day precautions. One of the biggest worries about being a caregiver or a patient leaving the hospital is their environment. They want to make sure things are clean enough and that they feel like they're in a safe space where they won't be exposed to too many bacteria and infections. So one thing that's always a constant, this isn't because of transplant, it's not because the time of year, is to wash your hands frequently. That's patient and caregivers. You should be washing your hands before and after meal prep, before and after eating, obviously when using the restroom. But we just want to make sure that your hands are explicitly clean as often as possible. And we prefer and recommend liquid soap versus bar soap that some people leave at the table. We want you to continue taking showers every day. Again, in the hospital, we're going to encourage a shower every day or those antimicrobial wipes to get your skin clean. Your skin just likes to harbor lots of little things, and if you're not taking a shower every day, sometimes you're not washing all of that off appropriately. So please make sure you continue those. Follow safe food handling guidelines. You're going to meet with one of our awesome dietary staff as part of your transplant pre-planning, and after transplant, while you're in the hospital, the dietary staff follows you, make sure you're getting appropriate calories, and they talk to you about how to follow safe food handling precautions at home, eating out, all those kinds of things. So make sure you take notes on that and always reach out to ask questions, because we have them as a great resource for us. Obvious, sometimes not obvious precautions, because as you go back to your daily life, you start to ask yourself a lot of questions about what you should be doing. One thing we always recommend is try to avoid busy times in public places. So if you guys are out of groceries, you need to run and get something for dinner, go. And the patient's allowed to go as well. The thing is, we don't want you going at 5 o'clock when everybody and their mother is trying to find something for dinner because they don't have anything that evening. So just avoid busy times in public places. No driving until it's cleared by your doctor. I cannot say that enough, because I myself have been driving down the highway and seen a patient I transplanted driving next to me without his wife in the car. So we had a chat about that when he came, but please try to remember that safety precaution. We encourage you to go outside. We want you to go outside. The important thing about going outside is sun protection. We're in Colorado. We're a lot closer to the sun, if you want to think about it that way. And in Colorado, I think the statistic is that you're about 50% more likely to get some type of skin cancer than you are at the beach. And so we encourage sunscreen. It's sunscreen, not summer screen, you guys. So we encourage it year-round, especially after transplant, an SPF of 30 or higher. We also encourage sun-protective clothing, long sleeves, long pants, wide-brimmed hats. I included this picture for any of you that get the opportunity to know Dr. McSweeney during your process. This here is a picture of him and his coordinator and their team at a golf tournament we host. And everyone was just in awe of Dr. McSweeney's sun protection. And he's not post-transplant, you guys. And he had absolutely every inch of his skin besides this much of his chin covered from the sun. And of this much of his chin in his pocket, he had some SPF 30 that he kept using throughout the day. Now, I don't golf, all right? I volunteer. So when he came up to the 18th hole where I was volunteering, I asked his team to pose in a picture for me that we can use in this class. So if you see Dr. McSweeney, tell him we said thank you for such a great example. So as far as cleaning at home, again, that's one of the big things. We encourage that the patients deep clean prior to returning home, that the caregivers have the house deep cleaned, whether you do that yourself or hire a company, that's fine. For those of you that are coming from further than 20 miles away and will be staying in our local housing, our cleaning company contracts with them, and they know the precautions to have those apartments and suites ready for you when you come out. So you don't have to go in ahead of time and do that. So just know that. We want you vacuuming the carpets and the drapes. We do not want you steam cleaning the carpets within 2 weeks of your loved one admitting to the hospital. So if you have a patient that's admitting, you know, tomorrow, 2 weeks ago is when the carpet should have been steam cleaned. This is a national guideline. A carpet here in Colorado is going to dry a heck of a lot faster than one in Florida, but we do want to give you that national guideline so you have that. There's plenty of dry chem options if your carpet does need to be cleaned, so we would encourage that instead of using a steam option. We want to make sure you're changing your furnace filters, and that's something that we usually request that you do monthly or per the manufacturer guidelines. So if you guys go to Costco, you can buy those, like, I don't know if they're 3-packs or 5-packs, and just follow the guideline and make sure you're changing out the furnace filters. And then make sure there's just no known areas of mold or mildew in the house. And if those are known, make sure those areas are taken care of before your loved one comes home. After transplant, we want to make sure that weekly you're providing vacuuming, mopping, dusting to the common areas of the house. For dusting, I don't know how many people still use feather dusters. They're pretty, but all they do is just sand stuff out. I've got volunteers in the class today who are raising their hand that they still use feather dusters. But make sure you're using a Swiffer type thing or a damp cloth that actually attracts the dust and takes care of it for you. We want to make sure you're cleaning your kitchen and bathroom with bleach products. And if you're completely have a horrible aversion to bleach, you don't like the smell, you don't like the residue it leaves behind, what we really care about is that the product you're using in your kitchen and bathroom and main common areas has a 99% kill rate. And so you see on the label of Lysol or 409, or there's products even at Whole Foods and things, the label has to say 99% kill so that we know you have a good bacteria coverage with your cleaning products. Bed linens and towels, we want you to change at least weekly unless the patient requires more frequently, but weekly should be fine when you come home. As far as daily precautions, we want to make sure you're wiping down the kitchen counters, the bathroom counters, all those shared areas every day with a bleach wipe or a Clorox wipe or something antibacterial, of course. And then ideally, we want the patient, when they come out, to have their own restroom. If for any reason the restroom has to be shared among family members or caregivers, we want to make sure that you're wiping down the toilet seat between every single use. So whether that's you or the patient or a visitor, we want to make sure that you're wiping that down every time if the toilet's shared. We talked about furnace filters. We do not allow swamp coolers. We're shortly going to be in the warmer months of Colorado, but any time of year, we want to make sure you don't have swamp coolers on. So if you think about what grows in a swamp, we don't want that blowing around your house after transplant, especially while you're taking those immunosuppression medications. You can always talk to your transplant physician about an appropriate time to turn these back on, but it's much preferred to have a central air kind of system, fans, those kinds of things. Plants are always an area of concern. As you heard Callie say, when someone, you're near in the hospital and people want to send you flowers, we don't allow fresh flowers or plants in the hospital. And that's because everyone's kind of gotten a large vase of flowers before, and the water's nice and clear and everything's so pretty. And within a couple days, the water starts to look a little off. And that's because there's things growing in it, and so we don't want that. Plants at home you can have. We just want to make sure that you're consolidating it to one area of the house that the patient probably doesn't go to too often. Clean your car on a regular basis. Everybody has left something in their car for too long, and need I say more, just make sure the car is clean if you're going to be transporting the patients back and forth. So let's talk about kids. Many of our patients and caregivers go home to children, grandchildren, and they're an important part of your life, and we care about them too. So we want to make sure that you're educated on how to best go home to children and how to make everybody function well together. The most important thing with kids is infection prevention. Kids, as you heard us say earlier, you can't have visitors during visitor times under the age of 14. That's because we've all watched a kid just walk through the house and wipe their hand on their sleeve and go get a snack out of the fridge, and they tend to spread things faster than they control it. So infection prevention with children is the most important thing. So we teach kids the importance of washing their hands and singing a song and washing them for 20 seconds and getting all the surfaces and in between and rinsing them well. And then we want to make sure that they are never allowed to touch that line that you come home with that's placed in your chest. If you're going home to infants or very young toddlers, we do not let the patients do any diaper or toileting care if possible. If it absolutely cannot be avoided, we need you to wear gloves and obviously adhere to strict hand hygiene. No mouth kissing little babies or children, or, you know, I have a 5-year-old. He comes up to me every day for a nice big old mouth kiss. But after transplant, you have to be really, really careful. And then we don't want you around any kids that you know are sick. So if they have sniffles or sore throats, or they're not feeling well, there's been a fever at school, you know, something like that. We want to make sure we're avoiding contact if and when all possible. And again, that goes back to that live vaccine. Those live vaccines, which are the MMR, the varicella, rotavirus, which is a ingestible vaccine, and then the intranasal flu. Those are all live vaccines, and anyone who's received one can actually shed those diseases for about 2 weeks. So we don't want them around the patients where they can pick those up and then become infected themselves. So how do we help kids? How do we help kids when their parents have cancer and when you're coming to a transplant and we take you away from them for a few weeks? Kids are really like little adults. They just want to help. Anyone who's ever had something done usually has a slew of people say, how can I help? What can I cook? What can I do? Kids are the same. And so it's important to give kids little jobs. You can have them draw a picture for mom or dad or be in charge of filling up their water jug or something. But kids just want to know that they're contributing to the overall well-being of their loved one. So make sure you're including them in those things. We encourage gentle contact, no roughhousing or jumping. I always tell people that I've seen a 2-year-old pull out one of those lines, and it is not good. So make sure it's covered and we're not roughhousing with the little ones. Rest when the kids rest. Old school rule, when the baby's sleeping, I'm sleeping, because everybody needs their rest. Keep medications out of reach. You know, this is so much easier said than done. When you leave the hospital or come to the clinic, oftentimes we'll give you, or the pharmacy will give you, a big pill box. And it's 7 days long, and it's got 4 different times a day for all these medications that you're going to be managing at home. And kids don't always think they're candy. Sometimes they do. But the example I love to give with that pill box is I care for my elderly grandpa on the weekend, and he's got pill boxes spread throughout his house for the different times a day that he's in different rooms. And the kids, they don't care what's in it, but they love to walk by and open all the doors. They think it's fun to push the buttons of the pill box just to open the doors. They don't care what's in it, but an elderly person, a post-transplant person, you pick up that box, those pills all go dumping out, and then they have to be replaced and reorganized and those sorts of things. So in addition to the safety effect with children, make sure you're keeping those meds up and out of reach so that they're just not tempted. And then please reach out to our psychosocial team for support. We have a wonderful psychosocial team that will assess your whole situation before you come into transplant. And we really want you to lean on them and use their resources for kids as well, because we love to support the whole family here, and we want to make sure that everyone feels that. Let's talk a little bit about pets. Lots of people go home to pets. The important thing about pets is that you can't get any new ones during the transplant. You can't celebrate your 100 days after transplant by getting a new puppy. New pets especially come with lots of bacteria and diseases. They need lots of vaccines, and it's just important to stick with the pets you have and not get new ones with transplant. We want to make sure that you discuss your pets with your transplant coordinator. Most of the time, pets are not an issue. There's certain species that we would prefer over others. And the only time I personally have had an issue with this is I had a patient who had 3 dogs, 10 guinea pigs, a huge fish tank, and like 5 birds in a very small apartment. And we had to make some adjustments and some alternate care options for those animals so that the patient could safely be cared for at home. Make sure you wash your hands after touching pets. You're encouraged to pet your pets and snuggle next to them and things, but we want to make sure you're washing your hands and being very safe. You cannot clean up after pets. That's one of those awesome caregiver duties, is that patients get a free pass for cleaning up after pets. And then we want to set boundaries. So for those of you whose pets, your dogs, your cats, currently sleep in your bed, we want to make sure that you stop those habits now, because we want to separate your eating and sleeping spaces so that pets aren't taking the paws outside and back in your bed or up on the countertop, those sorts of things. So if you have questions about that, please reach out to your individual coordinators so they can kind of help navigate that process for you. And then as we're wrapping up here, what I like to remind everybody is that each patient's recovery is different. If you're walking that L shape on the unit that Callie talked about, or that nice long single hallway, and you run into a buddy who's also got a transplant, you guys start talking numbers, it can be very discouraging to hear that the person that you have commiserated with for a few days is out before you or after you, and it gets really tough. So we like to remind you that you are your own person, your donor is a complete individual, and getting those together sometimes can be challenging, and we just want to focus on you. So don't compare yourself to others, and just remember that everybody is different in this process. Our goal is to get you back to the normal things in your life. We'd like to get you back to work and all sorts of activities, but there are time frames for those things to happen. One of the members of our team you're going to meet after transplant is our long-term follow-up coordinator. So in addition to that post-transplant coordinator who's helping manage your day-to-day, at some point you'll meet with our long-term follow-up coordinator, and their job is to let you know, when can I travel? When can I drive? Not yet. When can I drink wine? Am I allowed to have sexual relations with my partner? All of those things, they'll be able to answer those questions and give you guidelines and timeframes on how to get those things back into your day-to-day. But just remember, it's different for everybody, so make sure you're speaking with your physician and your coordinators to help get back there. So to close out our presentation today, we're gonna play this video for you. We had a patient who lovingly, voluntarily videotaped her own stem cells being infused through her line. And as you watch the video, I believe for your screen, it'd be on the very left side of the IV tube. There's a darker line, and if you zoom in and look really closely, you can see these teeny, 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 tiny little clusters, and those are the cells. Those are your stem cells marching on in, evicting that renter, and taking over the space for themselves. And that's what we want to happen. So there's no volume to the video or anything to protect the patient's privacy, but she did volunteer this video to us so that you all can kind of see what that looks like and what to expect when you come to the hospital. And lastly, you guys, since this is not a live forum and we can't take questions as we go, I've included this slide that lists the contact for each physician. So depending on the physician who's going to be in charge of your transplant, every one of them has someone like me. I'm Nicole Martinez. I work with Dr. Ali. But every one of our physicians has a pre-transplant coordinator that can help further clarify this content that you've learned today and answer any questions that have come up. But we really appreciate your participation. We're very grateful for your time. And if there's something we can do or something you'd like to see in the future, please let us know.